You have a prepaid call from...
Oh.
An inmate at... This call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded. To accept this call, say or dial 5 now. Thank you for you...
What up, Boos?
Stop.
Yeah.
What's up, Boos? Yeah, man, I just got your email. I mean, when I was in Calipan, hey, homie, there was a CO getting hit almost every week. Every week, staff was getting assaulted and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And then I heard they was doing that in Sentinella, but that was when I was in Calipan back in 99, 2000.
Uh-huh.
It was the last time I was down south. All these years, ever since 99, 2000, I've been stuck up north, in all the northern prisoners. I've been up New Folsom, Tehachapi, Kern Valley, Salinas Valley, Lancaster.
This call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded.
Corcoran, Corvershoe, Corvershad F, man, I've been... been like 10 different prisons right now and stuff.
Yeah.
This is the first time in 20-some years that they let me come down south.
You like it down south better than up north? Because I know down south, they ain't got no Nathaniels, you know what I mean? Or do they? I don't know. I've never seen no Nathaniels down south.
Oh, no. Well, in Salinas and Pelican Bay, that was like the headquarters and stuff. When
yeah.
I was in Salinas, we used to do business with them dudes all the time and stuff. Every time something happened, they would always come and get at us. We need something done, we will get at them. We'll get at their leaders and stuff. Like, it was crazy. But they had the craziest politics, though. They weren't allowed to drink. They weren't allowed to do drugs. They had mandatory workout all day. They had mandatory study sessions. They had, they had a shadow. Their leaders everywhere their leader go, they had to shadow him. Like maybe 4, 5, 6 of them will be right behind him. You know, they had some crazy politics, man. They had the craziest ones. And every little mistake they made and stuff, they was just paying for it and stuff. I just left a couple years ago, Salinas, on my yard. Like 3 of them dudes ran into that dude's cell and stabbed the crap out of him and killed him. They locked him in the door in the cell and just 3-on-1 him and stuff, killed him.
Yeah.
Had him like 100 some time. But, I did time a lot those, the dudes from the Mixing Mob, dudes from the NS, BGS, AB.
They go straight to the shoe, right?
The shoe with a lot of them. Back then, yes. They was indeterminate. They stayed in the shoe forever, but. In 2012, me and 12 other guys in the SHU, we became the lead plaintiffs in a lawsuit we filed against the CDCR about keeping us in the SHU forever on indeterminate without letting us go and stuff. So, now the new policy is now they got the Mexican Mafia, AB, BGS, now they got them all over the mainline now.
How they validate you?
You know?
What evidence did they gather for you to validate you?
They didn't validate me because I wasn't from a prison gang like that.
You have 60 seconds remaining.
Gang, but they got me on an indeterminate show because I kept on coming back for stabbing cases. I was always stabbing somebody and stuff.
Yeah.
A lot of violence and stuff. Because you keep coming back, they gotta keep you in the hole as long as they want. They only release you when they feel like releasing you.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I was one of the, I was the only other in the state of California that was in that lawsuit. Yeah. I might send you a copy of it so you see.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I knew a lot of them dudes. One of the new arrivals and first termers in prison. There's a vetting process, which is a complete background shit, prison style, before a homie is fully accepted into the group, which is called a car. We'll look into them and run a background check. You'll be obliged to fully cooperate, such as producing a file, that is your or CDC 128G Chronicle, which will show your arrest history and criminal history. You must produce your abstract of judgment, get your conviction and sentencing records, and you must produce any paperwork or information requested from you to complete your vetting process. You will not and cannot lie or try to mislead the homies about not having your info. We heard all the excuses like a dog in my paperwork. In the event your paperwork is unavailable, the homies will allow you a grace period of at least 90 days to produce your documents. You want to know if you're a sex offender, a rapist, child molester, a rat, an informant. Any one of those is enough to get you targeted and killed. It is highly unacceptable. It may result in your throat cut open, your head cut off, your disembowelment, a weapon penetrating your heart, you being brutally beaten to death, strangled, etc. I've seen it all. Sometimes killers get creative, cutting out intestines, eyeballs, hearts, displaying decapitated heads on the lockers, and sometimes posing the bodies on the bed. Or at least sometimes CEOs won't know you're dead until you start stinking. But you go through that vetting process, and once you clear, you clear. In the meantime, you just you're gonna be laced up. You want you clear, you can be laced up. You're gonna be walked around the track telling you where not to go, where to go, where boundaries are belong to what group. You'll walk the track and you'll see, okay, this is where the whites kick it at. This is where the southern Mexicans kick it at. This is where the Bloods kick it at. This is where the Crips kick it at. This is where the Norteños kick it at. And this is where the others kick it at. That's the Asian Pacific Islanders. After that, you know, they usually go through a kind of like a training and stuff where, you know, they're going to teach you, the homies going to teach you how to make, you know, they want you to know how to make weapons, how to defend yourself. You know, what to say, what not to say, how to carry yourself, you know, how to talk to people. You know, you got to be respectful when you talk to people, you got to have tact, you got to be diplomatic. You know, there's all kinds of ways you're going to start picking up and stuff, different prison lingo and stuff. And, you know, they want you, it's a brutal process and stuff. When you get a job, you know, whatever job you get assigned to, like the laundry room, canteen, program office, education, your job is to look out for the homies. You know, if you can benefit the homies, you're going to have to give in, you know, look out for them, like get them a fresh roll of laundry, get them paper, pens, stuff like that. You know, you're working the system and stuff. But at the same time, you try to do your own thing, you're going to start having homies on your ass, you know? You ain't looking out for us, you ain't doing what you're supposed to do for the car, you ain't contributing to the car in any way. So you got to get out that job. You resist, you know, they'll remove you. But, you know, one of the things that they want you to do is read. Learn how to read, write, study. Read up on history books, science books, religion, politics, philosophy. You know, they want you to have some kind of hustle. Learn how to sew. Do electronic work, fix people's TVs and radios if it needs to be fixed. Know how to tattoo, draw, arts and crafts type of stuff. They want you to know all that stuff. And be honest with you, the homies do not like dumb homies. You know, if you're a dumb homie, I mean, that's just straight up. They're going to, they're going to be looking down on you and stuff. They might love you or something like that, but it's just a weird feeling and stuff because, nobody want to mess with a dumb homie, you know? That's just keeping it real and stuff. So, you want to study. Every now and then, homies got time in the ACL to study something, talk about something decent, you know, educational. They want you to work out. It's like mandatory workout sometimes. Sometimes it all depends on what car it is. They want you to work out, exercise, You know, it's like a military boot camp training. Yeah,
no,
the
question I have is, if a homie has to be removed, what's the process of removal? I mean, take us through the process of the removal, and what substantiates the removal? What qualifies as, you know, a removal for him?
If it's a discipline thing, like he's being disciplined for something, they'll probably just jump on him, send a couple of dudes, three dudes, jump on you. And that right there is enough to get you removed from the yard. If you come back to the yard, they'll send another two to jump on you, or another one to jump on you to get you removed from the yard. Because once they jump on you, you're considered a threat to the car. They don't want you to be around the homies, because as far as they're concerned, you're going to retaliate. You might say, no, you accepted your ass whooping, you accepted the discipline. But for security purpose, the homies say, you can't stay in the yard. Now you got to go start off fresh in another yard. Now, if it's owing money and stuff like that, like disciplinary reasons, that's what usually happen right there. But if you got to go because you're vetting.
This call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded.
If you some kind of a sex offender or informant and stuff like that, you know, you fail the vetting process, they're going to send somebody at you with the weapon, or they will get you removed with the weapon and stuff. And usually, back in my day when I first started in the system, if you didn't maim somebody, if you didn't kill them or maim them to where they got to get carried off the yard in a stretcher, people start making fun of you. So when you're putting a demolition down, you want them to be carried off on a stretcher, or you want to be, I want them to be carried off in a body bag. But yeah, there's a lot of, I've seen a lot of them dudes come in and go out that way too, you know?
Yeah, and the other question I have about that is, when they get removed, right, out the yard, say they're not a sex offender or nothing, they violated some type of rules or obligation in the car, right? When they get removed from a different yard, a different prison, don't that follow them when they can get removed there as well?
No. If it's a discipline thing, usually you'll have your paperwork with you, because it'll say on your paperwork that you got assaulted by a few inmates. Nowadays, it's so easy to vet you because everybody in the general population has a cell phone. And we're all going to be calling each other, vetting you through the cell phones. Because back in the days, we used to send kites. You know, if a homie getting transferred to this prison, he'll take a kite with him and stuff. That explains all that stuff. But if you get disciplinary, if it's a disciplinary reason, you got removed from the yard, then you'll be accepted on another yard. But once you get to that new yard, when there's a demolition that needs to go down, like somebody not to get whacked or hit, you're going on that mission to make up for your mistakes. So not only are you getting your ass whooped for disciplinary reasons,
this call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded.
You're also going to risk your life getting a life sentence or something because you had to go on a mission to make up for your mistakes. You have to make up for your mistakes and stuff.
Right, and the other question I have is, besides that, that individual being chosen, right, to make mistakes, besides that, don't they got specific individuals like you know, part of the wrecking crew or something, like things of that nature that specifically do that?
Yeah, usually, when I started all my time and stuff, back in the early 90s and stuff, that's how we always had it and stuff, too, and stuff. As soon as a homie steps in, we were all eager. We were all eager, man. I'm a warrior. Who needs a candle? Let me know. You need me to step up with something? Let me know. Give me a knife. Do I need to stab him? Do I need to do this? Homie's going to be stepping up. There ain't going to be no problems with homie stepping up. Everybody wants stripes. Everybody want to boost their status. You know, everybody's mad, angry, bitter. So they're going to take out whatever they can on the target and stuff. And, we usually got crews like that you know, they're still, don't give a shit. All they want to do is do. And that's the kind of crew I was in. You know, I couldn't wait for somebody to mess up. I couldn't wait for somebody to do something. And, you know, just, you know, it made me feel good when I hurt somebody and stuff. You know, it was weird, yeah. You always had somebody in the car that wants to perceive himself as somebody strong, somebody political, somebody that'll do anything that needs to be done to keep the car status high and popular, you know? The more fear you instill in the car, the more it seems like it's the more respect people give you and stuff, you know?
You have anything to say, Uso, to our youth, man? Like, you know, anything to say, like, you know, to them? Like, you know, is this actually worth it? You know what
yeah.
I mean? Like, trying to get clout and all that stuff? Is that, you know what I mean? Like, doing
yeah.
what they're doing?
Prison is not a place to come to. You think you're going to be coming over here thinking you're going to be cool and you're going to be somebody, but eventually you will get caught up. Eventually, if you came within little time, you'll likely can't get out with the life sentence. You know, I've seen guys come in with a couple years to do, and because they messed up, we had to send them on missions and get broken off. And, you know, it's not fun in prison, man. So it's not the same. You think you're going to come, but when you got somebody, the police and the homies telling you how to program, how to survive in here, then, you know, it's just... Yeah, one of the things is we want everybody waking up at 6 o'clock in the morning, folding up your bed, and suited and booty, got your shoes on, you're supposed to sit up like that all day. You know, it is not fun in here, man. I've seen so many people get killed with my own eyes. So many people just coming in with little sentences and getting out, going back to court and getting broken off life sentences and stuff. We have a lot of homies like that. Me? I picked up an extra 20-something years in prison because of that same reason. Well, I didn't care and stuff. But now...
You have 60 seconds remaining.
It's not good, man. You know, I pray every day, ask Lord, God, to forgive me of my sins. Forgive me of all the things that I've done and stuff. And now I recognize all that, and it wasn't even worth it. Anyway, the phone's gonna cut off on us any second now, dog.
Hey, homie, it's great hearing from you again, homie. And you have a good night, homie.
All right, you too, brother. Send my to your family and everybody. And much love. God bless you, brother.
All right, bro. You too.